Thank you very much, Ulrike, for the kind introduction. And thank you very much for inviting me here. It's a real pleasure for me to be traveling again. It's my first trip since all the lockdown periods. And congratulations to all of you for obtaining the funding. That's fantastic. Congratulations for filling all the positions. I just heard that. So I would like to point your attention to a very important thing here. I still have vacant positions in Aarhus. So if what I tell today is of any interest, please spread the word and send the next applicants in my way. So, and you can see it's not that far away. It's there's even a direct Ryan flight I learned yesterday. Okay, so what is this talk about? It's about the, I termed it the inversion problem in surface science. And what is the inversion problem? Well, sometimes it is that you have some reciprocal space information about a surface from some diffraction measurement. Or it could be that you have some very nice STM or AFM observation of a surface, and you have something there. Either you have the structure of the surface itself, or you have put down, as in this case, platinum 10 atoms on an oxide surface, and you are asking the question, in all cases, what is the structure behind what we are seeing here? What is the structure responsible for the diffraction pattern, for the STM or AFM observation, and what is the structure behind those blobs, those 10 platinum atoms? Or the inversion problem could also be, what would be the best catalyst you could form of any of these surfaces or any of those particles you put down, and how should you, what should you add to them to get the optimum catalysis and so on? That's another way of having a more challenging inversion problem. And as Ulrike alluded to, I've been in the business for many years, and I'll give you now the historic tour of how this inversion problem is solved, in part because we're not there. But let me start by taking you back some 10, 20 years to how we used to do. We used to sort of be inspired and say, well, if I am to come up with the structure of those platinum catalysts or platinum particles I had on the previous slide, if I'm to come up with a theorist view on what is the structure, what is the most stable one, the thing I'll do is I'll guess it, then I'll give it to the computer and use the GPOR, the free DFT software, GPOR, that you can download, and then do some relaxations on your supercomputer and get a final structure which is the nearest, most stable structure given your guess. And then I'll repeat it over, have another guess, and do a new relaxation, and continue like this. And 20 years ago, this was what we were doing all the time. And then you could sort of follow in the literature that the results, they depended on the imagination of the human being that had been doing the simulation. So you can find for gold 8 on F centers on magnesium oxide supports, you can find one scientific paper claiming that this is the most stable structure. And then 4 years later, the same group has apparently discovered a new structure. I omitted the name of the people. It's not so important in this context. We entered the field in 2007 and immediately found a new structure, which was better than the previously proposed, which could be reproduced. And we realized that this is not a viable way of going about finding the structure. So if you think about it also, I mean, not only do you not find the right result, but also you're hampered by all the time you're spending in setting up your initial guesses. So what is it that has to be done to do this better? Well, you need to bring in the machine so that it's the machine that comes with the initial guess. And I'll give you throughout this lecture four different ways of getting this initial guess from the machine. And the first way we do it here started back in 2007 is by accumulating a population of structures that the computer has dealt with, and then have the machinery do some kind of mutation or crossover operation. So that would be rattle all the atomic positions to get a new candidate structure, or to take two structures, cut them in halves, glue them together, and have a new child structure. And then, naturally, this is then called an evolutionary algorithm or a genetic algorithm, where you carry along information from old structures you have considered. And then if you treat them as a population, you keep only the best ones, the ones that respond the best to the environment, and that is, in this case, the ones that are most stable. And if you do this, you can now automate it, and you're not hampered by human imagination, and you can just have the computer do this. It will not run dry of starting cases here. It will sometimes, as I try to depict here, it will sometimes make some new guesses that are worse than those you had previously. But that's life when you adopt these methods. So let me give you an example. We take the exact same system I had on the previous slide, a couple of slides ago, the gold 8, and then search for the optimum structure, and something comes out. That's actually one of those we reported previously. But then there's also another one here and yet another one there. And if we place them on an energy scale, they are even way better than the ones that were found via human imagination. And they're not that, I mean, they're not that different. Some of them, I mean, this one is just rotated 45 degrees compared to that one or something. But it takes a human to have that idea, or it takes a machinery and very many attempts to get that idea. And then most strikingly is that in this case, the optimum structure we found is sort of beyond human imagination, because it's an upstanding particle. And Günther is almost shaking his head here. That can never be true. I have never seen that. And probably not, because this is with one exchange correlation functional, the PBE. And as soon as you apply something where there's van der Waals interaction, then all the other ones, they will gain a little bit of energy because they lie flat on the surface, whereas this one that stands up will suffer and will no longer be the most stable. But that's not part of it. I mean, we were asking the question, with the PBE exchange correlation functional, which one is the better structure? And we should have found that back at the turn of the century, immediately, had human imagination been good enough to give the right answer. But it's just not the case. That's my point. Okay, and I have a couple of other examples. I need to show this with Ulrike here, and there are others who have worked on titanium dioxide. But if you zoom in on this step edge here, and you try and make the atomic structure by cutting away material from the bulk, then you would guess that the structure should be something like this. And even if you did some human-guided attempts, you would end up finding the best structure. You would probably end up finding this as your best guess. But when you run the evolutionary algorithm, which doesn't know anything about crystal structure or anything, it just places the atoms, rattles them, and so on, then it comes up with this proposal, namely that one of your titanium atoms should occupy a non-bulk position. It's perhaps hard to see, but this is the same position as when you have an interstitial deep in the bulk. Now it's just an interstitial that lives right at the surface. And it turns out that that this is more stable than the thing up there. It takes some very tedious calculations, and you can find them in this and another paper, to actually prove that it's the more stable situation because it involved a different number of atoms. Here's another example, and that's reduced tin oxide surfaces. And in this case, we are back to also almost the turn of the century for the structural models that were put forward to explain the 4x1 periodicity of this surface. And then in 2016, Lindsay Merte, who was in Lund at the time, but is now in Malmö in Sweden, he couldn't explain his higher resolution lead IV curves and also some surface XRD data based on any of these initial models, and he couldn't come up with a new model that fitted sufficiently well that he trusted it. He came up with one that fitted better, but he didn't trust it. And not until we ran an evolutionary algorithm search did we find this solution. And I should say we scanned for the stoichiometry. We didn't know that there would be, I think it's 6 tin and 6 oxygen atoms in the surface layer. But not until we came up with that could we get a perfect fit with those observations. And this is the kind of situations you often end up with. Once you have seen the solution, it's an obvious one. I mean, like the gold standing upright, it's obvious in PPE it has to stand upright because gold up to gold 13 is most reactive at the perimeter. And in PPE it didn't have the van der Waals interaction. And in this case, these small clusters, they explain well the why it has to be a 4x1 periodicity, and also there's a glide plane in the diffraction information that can be explained via this. And once you see it, it's natural. Okay, I should have thought about that. We've seen that a number of times. Okay. So now we have it. It's just to apply the evolutionary algorithm, and then we can solve anything. Well, not exactly, because if you think of it, what we did was we made random starting configurations. Then we spent a lot of DFT resources relaxing those in the DFT energy landscape down to the local minimum. And depending on the structures, we would sometimes end up with something which was worse compared to what we had, and therefore would not be used in the population, and it was sort of something done in vain and for no use. And we would keep doing this too many times. And the natural thing to do then is to sort of say, let's not throw away any data like we just did. Let's use all the data we have ever seen. Let's use that to set up a model potential. And that can be done in various ways. So that could be done, as I guess we'll hear in the next talk, with a neural network. It could also be done with Gaussian process regression. I hope von Lilienfeld will cover that tomorrow. I'll not cover the details in this presentation. I'll just say that if you have a lot of data, you can formulate a model energy landscape, and then you can use that model energy landscape for your relaxations. And suddenly you don't have this immense effort of relaxing every stupid candidate your algorithm comes up with. You are only spending the effort in evaluating the energy of that relaxed candidate. And you can do that over and over again. And we have just reduced the computational demand by two orders of magnitude if 100 times application of the energy is what it takes to do the relaxation. And I had a student, Espen, who did that after visiting with I forget his first name, Peterson at Brown University. Sorry about that. Applying basically a Bela-Paranello neural network for setting up the model potential. That is what Andrew Peterson is an expert in doing. And Espen then managed to run a simulation, in this case for platinum 13 cluster on an MTO support, and come up with this solution here. The most stable structure for that is a pyramid structure. And now you are thinking, you don't need to travel to the US and interact with Andrew and learn how to do Bela Paranello and neural networks and all this in order to come up with a pyramidal structure as your contender for the global optimum structure. But the thing is that if you count how many atoms it takes to build a pyramid, it takes 9 in the first layer, 4 in the next layer, that's 13, and then a 14th in the third layer. And I was discussing platinum 13. So the case is that this pyramid is hollow. And most of you had not realized that I would claim. And that we'll never find out, because now it's too late. But we can go back in the literature and see that there were some good people who spent quite some time addressing this problem back in 2016. And after spending a lot of time, they had come up with this structure, sort of a sausage-like thing on the surface as the best structure. And here are the 36 different configurations they found after the human-inspired search for the best possible structure. And here's the in the upper left corner, the best one they found. And I depict it again here. That is from Espen's search. And Espen's machinery actually found 7 other structures that were better than this one. And they were also missed in this human-guided search. So I think I've made my point now that humans cannot do it. Automated search methods like an evolutionary algorithm can do it. And even when it goes via a machine learning potential, when it does the search, can it do it? And here's just to point out that the pyramidal structure is here. That's the hollow one. And up here, we have other pyramidal-like structures, but none of them are hollow. So it was not that the poor guy that I'm exposing here who did this work did not think that it could be pyramidal-like, but he also had this feeling it has to be solid because metals are solid. And of course, it matters whether you have one or the other model. It doesn't matter for CO. Sorry, surface scientists who always use CO as the test probe. But it matters for ethylene that binds way stronger on the wrong model. Okay, let's go back and revisit here now. Where is it we are spending our time? This time we are doing only one DFT calculation per structure, and that's fine. We cannot do less than that. But we are dealing with what I claim here is low-quality initial guesses because they're just made completely stochastically. We're not, apart from picking the parent structures for these guest structures, we're not exploiting very much the past knowledge that we have. Then we exploit some of it in the relaxation, but the relaxation will only take us very locally down in energy near where we start. So the initial guess suffers from being very stochastically generated. And a couple of years back, we got this idea that why not, instead of building a population, why not build a machinery, we ended up calling it an agent, a neural network-based agent that collects all the information that we have gathered so far and utilizes that to build in a more informed way a good new starting candidate for this relaxation. And then once we have relaxed it, we take it apart into pieces and then we give that back to our experience base so that we can build it better next time. And then every time we have built something new, we take the new structure we have built and use for training of our agent, and also we take from our experience base some previous pieces. The agent should act in this way. It should, whenever it sees an incomplete structure, it should see it somehow. I mean, here that's how humans sees atoms as circles. We opted to program it so that it sees it as atoms. And you can see we have the periodic boundary conditions here. It's a carbon nano ribbon that I'm depicting here. And then the agent should run over this image with a convolution. That's for the neural network experts in the audience. It should be collected in a number of hidden layers. We had 10 hidden layers, 3 hidden layers, and 3, no, 10, what are the kernels in each layer. And then the network should end up printing out a sort of a blueprint for the machinery that builds. So the agent saw this and suggests that if you are to place more atoms near those that are already there, the best places to place them would be these ones, these places that are pointed out by the blue raster colors. And then if I collect all this as this agent here, then basically it runs like this. The agent is presented with empty space or the atoms that are already placed and should not be shifted around. And then it places one by one atoms according to some policy. And the policy is called epsilon greedy, which means that in most instances, it just places an atom where it expects to get the highest reward. And I will return to the reward in a minute. And in a few instances, it will place the atom nearby. That's what this green base means. Or in very few instances, it will place it completely randomly. That's an explorative move then when it does that. But in most of these cases, it places the atom exactly where it also believes that it will get the highest reward. Now, at the end of this, it has a complete structure. And the complete structure means that we can perform a DFT calculation. The DFT calculation we convert into a reward. So if the total energy is low, it's a high reward. If the total energy is high, it's a low reward. And then we had the training and the backpropagation. And as you go about this loop here, your agent becomes more and more proficient. Let me illustrate this in two dimensions for some carbon atoms. And we have periodic boundary conditions. We are at episode zero. The agent has never been trained. It's a randomly initialized neural network. It knows nothing, and it gives you this random noise when it sees the first atom. And then the policy says, pick the highest point in this blueprint here. That happened to be there. Pick the highest now that you see two atoms, and so on. It keeps doing that and ends up with this ridiculous structure. But now it has something to train on, because now it knows what the DFT energy of this is. It can convert that into a reward. It can train the network. Perhaps it needs two structures before it can sort of discriminate between good and bad. But anyhow, it can do that. And after 200 episodes, this protocol means that the agent has learned this. When it sees the first atom, it's no longer just presenting you with white noise. It's presenting you with opportunities of getting a high reward if you place an atom near to the one already placed. So let's do that. And now the same agent trained these 200 times, given this input here, says, if you are to get the high reward, you should place the next atom at either end of this dimer and at either end of this dimer and so on. So it starts building a linear chain. That's what it has taught itself without any intervention of human beings. And it keeps doing that until it runs out of space. It's a given boundary condition that it has to place, I think it's 24 atoms. And the last ones, they must be placed at some new places. And you can see here, it's the convolution that decides, because this is really the sort of the result of a convolution, when it sees the same thing at several places, it also gives you the same output. So we placed the last two atoms, and now we are ready to train again. And 800 episodes later, the agent now suggests this. Given the first atom, the next atom should not be placed as close. We shouldn't form a triple bond right away. We should place it at a little bit further distance. And once we have done that, we should not continue to build linear chains. We should build at an angle. And we should keep doing that. And as you see here, the agent ends up filling the entire space in a way that gives you graphene, as you have guessed. And it's not the world's most complicated problem, I know. But we can present this, the agent and this protocol to harder problems. So here, for instance, we gave it four silver atoms and two oxygen atoms and asked it to place them on the silver 111 surface. And I forget, 500,000 episodes later, it actually is capable of now giving you the blueprints. And we have two channels this time because we have two species, the blueprints for silver and oxygen. And if you follow that, you will build what happens to be the most stable cluster of silver 4, oxygen 2 on this surface. And we can inspect it if we give it some input here where we are missing only one silver atom. Then I can immediately depict to you here what is the blueprint for placing the last silver atom. And it looks like this. And then we can present the agent with a slightly rotated version of our cluster. And you can see this same agent is capable of pointing out almost the same spot every time. Even though it has, it hasn't necessarily been trained on all of these situations, but it can generalize. It has been trained on, and I should have known the number, but I think it's about 1,000 episodes, 1,000 different structures it has seen, and it can give you, I mean, it has already given us more than 1,000 different suggestions for rewards. I mean, there's like 400 pixels in this image, and then this occupies a bit of it. So let's say there's 200 pixels. So when I'm through five of these images, I've already gotten 1,000 reward readings out of my neural network. It was trained on only 1,000, and they look completely different. But it's capable of generalizing. And here I get another 1,000 when I click five more times. And I have another test case down here. So here I've split my my cluster in two pieces. And I ask the question, where should I put the last silver atom as I near these two pieces each other? And you can see here, it nicely discovers that at some point, there's no more space for a silver atom in the middle, and it should be pushed out on the side. Again, thousands of readouts of rewards. But we never did thousands of DFT calculations when we trained the neural network. It shows the power of the neural network. And this was actually a first step. These agents were trained first to solve that silver 4, oxygen 2 problem. And then they were asked to solve this silver 12, oxygen, I forget, 6 problem that Geo and others took 6 years to solve. So Geo was given this problem in 2000. that's the claim, but I assume you read the scientific literature. So in year 2000, Geo, the responsible Geo, read about this problem and saw this suggestion for the solution or the inversion of this STM image. He said, that cannot be true. And 6 years later, Geo was ready. With, let's see, you are down here. No, it's true. You're exceptional. You did it in 1 month. But here's, it doesn't compete with the computer, because the computer was given this. I mean, from this we read out, OK, there are apparently no atoms in the corners. So we took away the corners. And we decided it's OK to take the right number of atoms in this case. And then we asked it to solve for the most stable structure in just 2D. So atoms were also constrained to be in one plane, and that's not the real solution. Some of the oxygens, they flip out of the plane and so on. And then 5,700 episodes later, and that's less than 48 hours later, so that's your 1 month. The one of 10 agents, not all of them, but that we started, one of 10 agents came out with this solution saying that whenever you see this surface here, and there's a silver atom there, you should place an oxygen there, you should place a silver there, you should, and so on. I'll just step through them. This is the solution it came up with. And after that, obviously, it couldn't find anything better. So just to sort of demonstrate automated structure determination here, given information about the supercell and the stoichiometry. And just to prove that we don't even need the stoichiometry, we looked into this other surface. I missed the details. It's still silver 111, but it's another structure form, C4x8. And here we did the scan running through all kinds of numbers of silvers and numbers of oxygens that we put down. And also we lifted the constraint of only searching in 2D. And we found a number of interesting structures. And when you evaluate what they would cost to form compared to bulk silver and gaseous oxygen, you come up with the middle one there being the most stable. And when you make this simulated STM image, that's this one here, it looks, apart from the colors, just like what it should be. And this is just to give you an example of where we're heading now. We are heading into full 3D and asking the question, in this case, it's platinum 8 on graphene. What is the structure of that? And this is, again, after a couple of thousand episodes, the agents come up with this solution here. We cannot test that against anything. I don't have the real solution for this one, but that's not the point. Okay, I have to... and I only have 5 minutes left, I have to tell you the newest approach now. That is to say, why are we, every time we do a DFT calculation, why are we accepting this situation that we could start from a bad configuration? I mean, even when it's an agent that builds it, we saw some examples. Why are we accepting to spend all the efforts of doing a DFT calculation if we are coming from a bad starting point? Why don't we go parallel on this and make a whole lot of starting cases that we relax cheaply in our model potential and then end up with a number of structures from which we choose the most promising one? And then we only do the DFT calculation for that promising candidate rather than doing it for every candidate we can come up with. That's a very, very good, I praise myself here, sorry about that, but this is a good suggestion. It's I should immediately say it's Mal de Bispo, a student of mine who came up with it. The only thing is you don't know how to select the best one. I mean, if you just select the best one as the one with the lowest expected energy, then you are sort of reinforcing that what the model understands is also what you confirm with the DFT calculation in a minute. So let me illustrate this. If you have a true underlying energy landscape like the blue one, you have probed the energy landscape at all the red spots. These are previous calculations, and you can build a machine learning model. In this case, Gaussian process regression is used. Then you would come up with this model landscape, the green one, and you would perhaps pick the wrong one. I cannot see it from my angle here, but if this one is lower than the one over there, you would probably pick the wrong one. So you need to bring in the uncertainty also and say, if your model is very certain about this value, but it's more uncertain about that value, then this might be a better candidate. And therefore, you should do the exploration and the selection of this most promising candidate. You should do that not in the energy space, but in the space of an acquisition function that takes into account uncertainty by sort of artificially lowering the energy wherever uncertainty is large, like you see in these green regions up here. And this is most easily done with a Gaussian process regression or other types of regressions. It can also be done with neural networks, but then you have to have a number of neural networks and then ask the networks how certain are they about a given prediction, and then use their disagreement to estimate the uncertainty. And here we have Malte invented this, and here's a simulation for this. It's the titanium dioxide ANATAR's 1x4 reconstruction that comes out with it's a DFTB energy landscape we are searching in, as I recall it. And you can see here, this is the structure being tried out. Sometimes you try something very bad because of this uncertainty. But then eventually it will find out that there's a whole row of atoms that pucker out of the surface. And Malte, he applied it to a number of other complicated structures, like what is the most stable form of carbon-24. And it turns out that it's not just a structure involving 6 and 5-member rings. You also have to have 4-member rings in the structures. And if he measures here how long time it takes to find them, then they are, of course, more hard to find, but that it will eventually come out of this search. And over here is how graphene binds down to iridium. And there are some surprises that it prefers to make 5-member rings where it binds down rather than making 6-member rings that it could have done. Again, something that humans would not necessarily have tried out. And then in a wonderful collaboration with Malmö, Vienna, Lund, and then Malte in Aarhus, we have here investigated what could be responsible for this AFM image on an oxidized platinum tin alloy. And it turns out that it must be this structure that obviously no one would ever have guessed from human intuition. And with that, I'll just say here, unless some of you ask me, I don't have more detail, I'll just say that obviously now we reverted to just doing the mutation here. So every candidate we start from is again a poor candidate. And I had a whole midsection in the presentation where I said we need to make that more informed. And obviously that's what we are working on at the moment, that is to make a mixture of just stochastically sampled candidates and then more informed candidates. And with that, I'm through. I'll just thank the speakers here. This is a pre-COVID-19 picture, 2 years old. That's the last time these poor guys they escaped the lab. I took you through evolutionary algorithms, some that where we learned the potential on the go. Then there was the go-free approach, where we did multiple new structures and only evaluated the most promising. And then there was the part where we had the convolutional, the image recognition that would try and understand what chemistry goes on here, and then reinforce that understanding via self-training. And with that, I'll again thank, and I wish you good luck with the Sonderforschungsbereich, and I really hope to be involved in some of the projects. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Bjørk, for a wonderful talk. Great talk. I'm sure there are some questions. So since the whole thing will be live streamed, please wait until the microphone comes so I can ask a question.
A comment on the silver oxide first. That was Michi Schmidt who figured out the structure, not me. I checked the paper and then I remember. So he had already the structure in mind. He came to me, Georg, you need to check it, and that's the right one. He was pretty sure. Okay, so okay. First thing. Now you presented two approaches. One was the agent-based approach, and one was more this acquisition function, some sort of Bayesian process or Bayesian regression, where you use the uncertainty principle. What is your preferred approach at this point in time? Or are they used in different instances? I mean, it seems to be some overlap at least, right?
Definitely. Well, The I mean, I can say our current efforts, okay, exactly more or less the question I asked for. So I showed you this at the end, and I said, unless someone asks me, how would we combine it with this one, I would not say anything, but now I'll show this. So this is the method where we built according to the accumulated reinforcement learned understanding, and this is the 13 platinum atoms on the MGO surface, and this is an agent that has been trained for 500 episodes, and you can see it doesn't build the hollow pyramidal structure as it should. And the thing is that if you take this very same agent and instead give it a starting point like that, where it can still build a solid pyramid or it can build a hollow pyramid, then that agent that doesn't know how to build the final structure, it can at least complete a structure which has pieces of the solution. And I think that's the future in what we'll do. We'll combine the two. So if I go back to this, so we'll basically take, I mean, this is an okay approach to build it from scratch, but it just takes way too long. 500 episodes was not enough to be able to build the structure from scratch, but it was definitely enough to build it from, if you took a population member that had pieces of the right structure already and you completed it with your building scheme, rather than completing it with a stochastic or rattling it with a stochastic approach. And I think that's where we will end, that we will combine the two. Another thing we'll do is that we will abandon the principle of doing every search from scratch. Why should we do that? Why don't we accumulate a huge database of structures and teach or let agents teach themselves based on that database? Just like when AlphaGo and without any comparison to this, when they beat the champion of Go, they had been training their neural network for 42 days. They didn't start from scratch and played against him until they won against him. They had prepared the agent. In all I've shown here, we didn't prepare the agent. So we will go back and make protocols for doing that.
Hi, my name is Kesar, and I am second year PhD student and currently cast fellow in Professor Gunther Group. What I understood from the talk is that evolutionary algorithms, they are really good in solving the complex structures and to finding the best possible solution for this. I was just wondering that whether the approach which is adopted, this also use the deep learning models for actively acquiring the inherent properties of the material from the existing database, and does this approach is also good for rapidly evolving surface and structures?
I'm not sure I get. So I think I got the first part of the question. If we are also learning the properties of the materials,
yes, in so the that deep learning models that acquired the inherent properties of the materials in order to fit in the possible solution of the structure.
Let me try and respond what I think responds partly. I mean, you could easily accumulate also information about other properties, and that could be absorption energies of gases or stuff to some of these metal clusters. And then you could put that into your objective function, so the reward you get is not solely based on stability, but it's also based on how good are these at adsorbing gases. And then you could search for functional materials. I'm not sure if that's what you're asking, but yeah.
So does it mean that to in this order, you need to train the system further? You need to develop the more training to the system so that you will have the possible outcomes according to the different applied conditions?
It's a you have to put into your reward function. So, and you also have to, the relaxation you did should perhaps also be, I mean, the acquisition should also be knowledgeable about properties, yes. But it's a second generation project after we can solve structure. Yeah, okay. But it's a very good direction to take.
Thank you.
great talk. My name is Alexander Genes, I'm also working in Professor Ruprecht's group. My question is, how transferable are your neural networks? So if you change, for example, silver to gold or to copper, do you have to actually retune your neural network, or can you reapply parts of it?
We definitely have to. I mean, in this case, we only transferred the agent in that one case where we had the silver clusters and then went for the complete silver overlayer. And that worked out. But if you were to do this for another, I mean, first of all, there's practical problems of lattice constants and stuff. Basically, these agents are trained rather specifically. And also the descriptor we are using, so the way they see the structure sometimes involved a fixed number of atoms and cannot be transferred. But clearly, that's another avenue where one would try and make general agents, definitely, yeah. Good question.
So, thanks. Yeah, very nice talk. How did you read my mind? And I have to train my poker face. Maybe. Now, because at the point I was really wondering about the stability of such an wall of gold atoms. But in the hollow platinum, I mean, because finally we knew it's Uli Heitz and Landmann, but they make the clusters in the gas phase. And so the platinum 13 in the gas phase then probably does not have this void, or is hollow, or who knows.
It depends on how efficient the soft landing is. And
yeah, exactly. Yeah, did you also look at sort of the stability or the structure of the unsupported, if this has this void? No,
actually not. No, I don't think it has. Actually, I even didn't look into the origin. I think there must be some homolumo gap or some band gap opening up on the surface, and one could see if that is also there in the gas phase. I didn't check.
But apparently
we were just thrilled about the complexity.
But if you leave away the 13s from the top and put it in the center, that is apparently less stable.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And also if you take one of the corner atoms and put it in the middle and so on. It has been checked, yeah. It's very counterintuitive, this finding. Yeah. But actually, there's a study of slightly larger platinum clusters where people claim that there are hollow regions just below the surface, because the outer shell wants so much to be a complete shell with no holes or corners or step edges or something. And then that happens at the expense of including a little bit of hollow space inside the cluster. That has been reported. And that could be the same effect. Yeah.
Let's thank Bjørk again.